Hello everyone, welcome to Meat, Fish, Poultry Process Technology Lecture Series. My name is Shiva Prasad. I am an Assistant Professor, Department of Food Technology, Vignan's Foundation for Science, Technology and Research. So in our today's deliberation, we will be having a discussion on one of the important topics, that is slaughtering technique and principles, and also how exactly one has to conduct post-mortem inspection. So in our previous lecture, we have had an elaborate discussion on what are all the pre-slaughter handling as far as animal is concerned, wherein we have exclusively discussed the process that is involved in the transportation of the meat animal, and also what is the importance and objective of pre-slaughtering rest, and also the principle, objective, as well as the process towards antemortem inspection. So in our today's lecture series, we will try to understand what are all the processes that are involved after the antemortem inspection. Okay, so let us begin with our today's lecture. So after antemortem inspection of an animal, after it has been provided with sufficient time of resting period, or the importance of which we have already studied, okay, so after that the animal will be carried to a place called as the stunning area. Okay, so how exactly the animal will be carried? So the animal will be carried or facilitated by means of mechanical canvas, or it can be a rolled plastic, or it can be prodded just to move forward. Okay, so that is how the animal is moved from one places, that is the place of resting, that is called as lairage, to the stunning area after having a sufficient resting period. Okay, so after that, herein I have given you a picture which effectively describes and shows you and gives you an idea. So how exactly the animal will be carried from the lairage to the stunning area. So this is a picture of a horse being carried by a mechanical mean from a lairage to the stunning area. Okay, so however, if the animal is resisting itself to move forward, so it is of utmost priority that one must never follow tail twisting as well as the beating of an animal. So these two things are effectively forbidden. Okay, so it must not be performed whenever an animal is restraining to move forward. Okay, so there are certain laws which are governing this particular thing, so that there is no kind of a torture that the animal is being subjected to. So whatever the stunning process or whatever the slaughtering process that we are adapting, so we will have to make sure that the animal is not in any kind of a discomfort or in pain. So the humane method of slaughtering has to be employed, and it should be in place in every other slaughtering industry. Okay, so let us now try to understand what exactly the stunning process means. So let us define the term stunning first. So the stunning is nothing but as a process of inactivation of animals so that it will not be able to move. So that means whenever we are inactivating an animal, the function of the brain is stopped. Okay, so it will be under a halt. So in turn, the animal will not experience any kind of a pain or discomfort. So that will in turn facilitate and gives us a way, and we can move forward with the slaughtering protocol. Okay, so to ensure that the animal is not in any kind of a discomfort, and to see that we are humanely slaughtering an animal, we will have to employ a particular type of a method that is called as stunning. Okay, so it will in turn inactivate the animal, and the animal will not be able to move. Okay, so that is of an important concern. So stunning ensures that the animal is unconscious before it is slaughtered in order to eliminate any kind of a pain, as I've already said, the discomfort and also stress from the procedure. Okay, so the slaughtering technique will cause a lot of discomfort to the animal, so we will have to ensure that it is humanely slaughtered. To for doing that, we will have to perform stunning as an important operation. Okay, so many countries have legislation that requires pre-slaughter stunning. So most of the countries, say it US and other developed countries, so they have certain laws which in turn governs and then make sure that the animal is subjected for stunning protocol prior to slaughtering procedure. Okay, so whenever we are talking about stunning, so there are the three important types of stunning techniques. So the first one is the mechanical stunning. So this type of mechanical stunning will be performed by using wooden hammer, captive bolt, or by mechanical gun. Okay, and next one is the chemical method of stunning of an animal, which is mostly the anesthetization. Okay, so wherein most of the chemicals will be used so that it will induce any kind of a, you know, the animal will render the animal to unconscious state. Okay, so next one is the electrical stunning. The electrical means of stunning an animal is performed by subjecting an animal for an electric current of volt anywhere between 75 to 120 volt. So that is the voltage range where the animal will be subjected, or it will be, the electric current will be passed so that it will in turn render an animal to unconscious state. So thereby ensuring the stunning has actually happened. Okay, so let us now understand. So individual stunning process, that is mechanical, chemical, as well as electrical means. So the first thing we have, mechanical stunning. So whenever we are talking about mechanical stunning process, so as I've already told you, it is one of the most common method that is employed as far as stunning technique is in practice. So this is mostly for the large animals such as like the cattle. Okay, so they are in turn subjected for mechanical means of stunning. Okay, so this is one of the most common method which is employed, which is by means of striking the head with a hammer, that is the wooden hammer or captive bolt, or it can be a mechanical gun. So herein I have given you a picture which effectively gives you an idea. So how exactly we will have to target an animal as far as mechanical stunning is concerned. Okay, so let me just explain you what exactly happens. So whenever we are employing mechanical means, so as I've already told you, it can be the wooden hammer, the captive bolt, or it can be gun. That is mechanical gun. So these are the three devices which are effectively employed for mechanical stunning of an animal. Okay, so herein I have given you a picture of a cattle which is being subjected for mechanical means of stunning. So the target area for us is this. Why this is the target area? This will ensure that whenever we are striking the animal to the specific target side, that is at the head, so it will in turn inactivates the brain. So the brain of an animal will be inactivated. In turn, it will render an animal to unconsciousness. Okay, so that is what is of prior importance as far as stunning technique is concerned. Okay, so we will have to make sure that there is proper unconscious state, that is the animal is actually being to. Okay, so for that we will have to hit the animal head by wooden hammer, the captive bolt, or the mechanical gun. Okay, so also we will have to make sure that it should not be to such a level, that is the force that is employed or applied for causing the animal to undergo unconscious state, it should not be to an extent that it would damage the frontal bones, because if the frontal bones of an animal is damaged, it will in turn leads to brain hemorrhage. Okay, so which will again be a problem as far as the quality of meat is concerned. Okay, so whenever we are performing mechanical stunning, which is by the wooden hammer, the captive bolt, or with the mechanical gun, so we will have to target the specific site. Okay, so this specific site will in turn ensure that there is inactivation of the brain, and then the animal is rendered unconscious state. Okay, so also we will have to make sure that the pressure or the force that is applied should not be to an extent that it will render the frontal bones to be damaged, because whenever the frontal bones of an animal is damaged, it will in turn cause brain hemorrhage. Okay, so this picture effectively shows you how exactly at an industrial scale the mechanical stunning is performed. Okay, so the animal is targeted at a specific site, and a captive bolt or a mechanical gun is exclusively used so that we will in turn inactivate the part of the brain so that the animal attains unconsciousness. Okay, so this is about mechanical stunning as an important stunning technique employed in a meat industry. Okay, so the following which we have another method of stunning, that is chemical method of stunning, which is also called as anesthetization. That means The anesthetization means we are using or employing different kinds of chemical. As the name itself describes, it is chemical method of stunning. That means we are using or employing chemical or different types of chemical to render an animal to unconsciousness. Okay, so let us have an understanding on this particular anesthetization. So the anesthetization is exclusively carried out to swine, that is nothing but the pigs. So pigs are mostly employed for anesthetization process. So how exactly this anesthetization process happens? So the chemicals such as like the carbon dioxide, that is the gas, and also the oxygen which is present in the air, and also the chloroform. Okay, so these three chemicals are employed in a specific ratio, which in turn would render an animal to unconsciousness. Okay, so the carbon dioxide, air, as well as chloroform. So the chloroform concentration should be 0.18%. Okay, so that we'll have to effectively ensure. Okay, so the carbon dioxide plus air plus chloroform at a concentration of 0.18% must be employed as an chemical agent to render an animal to unconsciousness. Okay, so this is about the chemical method of stunning, and also the inhalation period of an animal of this combination of gases will last for 1 minute. So 1 minute is the time which is effectively taken into consideration whenever we are performing chemical method of stunning. That means after the combination of gases, okay, so these gases will be exposed to the animal, okay, for a period of 1 minute, which in turn will render an animal to unconsciousness. Okay, so commercially, in case of an industry, what ideally happens is, so they will be using exclusively carbon dioxide. Okay, so the carbon dioxide gas or the carbon dioxide chamber. Okay, so imagine this is a chamber. Okay, so this chamber has an access only to carbon dioxide. That means there is no air or oxygen that is present. So the animal will be taken into this particular area, ensuring that there is only carbon dioxide. So in turn, it will render an animal to unconsciousness. So these are the various methods and the techniques which are employed as an important chemical stunning techniques as far as meat industry and slaughtering of an animal is concerned. Okay, so this is about the chemical method of stunning. So the another important method of stunning that is employed is electrical method of stunning. So the electrical method of stunning, so how exactly it actually works? So as the name itself describes, so the electrical current is passed to an animal at a specific voltage depending on its size, if it is a large animal or if it is a small animal or if it is a bird. So depending on that, the animal will be exposed to a specific voltage of current for a limited duration of time. Okay, so let us have an understanding on the same. So whenever we are talking about electrical stunning, so we are employing electrical current at a volt of 75 to 120 volt for a period of briefly 15 to 70 seconds. So that is itself depending on the type of an animal. Okay, so through the hind part of the animal head, okay, in the region of parietal boxes by puncturing the skin. Okay, so we will have to ensure that we are puncturing the skin. In turn, we are rendering an animal to unconscious state. Okay, so herein I have given you a picture where the poultry, that is the chicken, is being subjected for electrical method of stunning. Okay, so this is the head of the chicken and we are piercing the skin. Okay, and we are subjecting these electrodes. So these electrodes will be subjected for electrical current at a volt of anywhere between 75 to 120 volts. Okay, so that is the voltage or the current. Okay, so that current will be passed through this particular electrode, which is piercing the skin, okay, in the region of parietal boxes. Okay, so we will have to puncture the skin at the parietal box region, which will in turn ensure that the electrical current that is being passed through the electrode is passed sufficiently to the brain, and in turn it will render the animal to unconsciousness. Okay, so this is about one method as far as the poultry is concern. So in case of large animal or medium sized animal, in case of pigs and everything, so we will have to pierce the skin at this particular region, okay, by puncturing the skin at the parietal box region, and then we will have to ensure that a proper voltage is passed through this particular electrode, which in turn will render an animal to unconsciousness. So this is about the electrical method of stunning. To give you an overview of what we had studied so far, so we have studied that stunning is a process which is employed to render an animal to unconsciousness, which in turn will facilitate the animal not experiencing any kind of a pain or discomfort or any kind of a stress. Okay, so the three important methods of stunning includes the mechanical stunning, chemical stunning, which is also called as anesthetization, and also the electrical method of stunning. So these are the important method of stunning techniques which are employed as far as the slaughtering of an animal is concerned. Okay. After performing stunning technique, so the next method that is employed effectively is the slaughtering process or the different methods of slaughtering. So as far as the religious sacrifice or religious practices is concerned, so how exactly the animal will be slaughtered? So let us have an idea on the same. Okay, so as far as religious method of slaughtering is concerned, so we have three important types. Okay, so the first one is the halal method, which is exclusively followed by the Islamic community, and also we have the jatka method, which is the second important method of slaughtering of an animal, which is followed exclusively by the Sikh community. And the next thing we have the kosher method. So this kosher method is exclusively followed by the Jewish community. So these are the three important slaughtering method which are in place and employed as far as the slaughtering of an animal is concerned. Okay, so let us have an understanding on individual methods of slaughtering. Okay, so first thing we have the halal method. So let us have an understanding. So as I've already told you, so the halal method of slaughtering of an animal is exclusively performed by the Islamic community. Okay, so how exactly this particular slaughtering method actually happens? Okay, so in case of halal method of slaughtering of an animal, we employ a sharp knife, and to make a swift deep incision that cuts the frontal throat, okay, the carotid artery, windpipe, as well as the jugular vein. Okay, so we will have to make sure that whenever we are making an incision with a sharp knife, okay, so there has to be specific kind of an incision. Okay, so as I have clearly shown in this particular picture, so the incision with the sharp knife has to be made at this particular area. Okay, so we will have to make sure that the carotid artery, windpipe, as well as the jugular vein in case of an animal is cut. Okay, so why exactly it is important? So the carotid artery, what it does, it will supply oxygen rich blood to the head, face, brain, as well as neck. Okay, so this carotid artery is present at the sides of the neck. Okay, so making an incision in the throat will ensure that there is a cut in the carotid artery, and the importance of carotid artery is that it will supply oxygen rich blood to the parts of head, face, as well as brain and neck. Okay, so next then we have the jugular vein. So what this particular jugular vein does, it will drain all the blood from head, face, brain, as well as neck back to heart. That means it will supply and it will drain all the blood from all these parts into the heart of an animal. Okay, so making an incision in the throat will ensure that there is cut in the carotid artery, which is a blood vessel. In turn, what happens, there is no oxygen rich blood that is supplied to all of this part, and in turn there will be cerebral anoxia. That means the brain will not receive enough of oxygen rich blood, and in turn the animal will undergo unconsciousness. Okay, so that is how important this particular halal method of slaughtering actually is. Okay, to give you an overview, In case of halal method, it is of an Islamic practice. It is mostly followed by Islamic community. So what they do is they use a sharp knife and make a deep incision in the throat, ensuring that the carotid artery as well as windpipe and the jugular vein of an animal is cut. Okay, so in turn, the oxygen rich blood will not be supplied and the animal will undergo cerebral anoxia. Okay, so that is about the process of halal method of slaughtering of an animal. Okay, so the animal is hung upside down. So after making an incision, the animal will be hung upside down. So this will ensure that there is complete drainage of the blood from the body of an animal, which is of utmost priority. So once all the blood from the body of an animal is completely drained, so it will ensure that the keeping quality of the meat is of important concern. So the microbiological keeping quality is of important concern, because if we have any blood that is remaining in the parts of the body or in the tissue, so what exactly happens is, since the blood is mostly with the most of the water, so it ensures that it gives a way to the microbial activity. Okay, so the microbial activity is exclusively influenced by the available moisture content or water activity. So if the water activity is increased, then it gives a way to the bacteria to proliferate, multiply and bring about the undesirable changes. Okay, so that is about the complete drainage of the blood as well as the keeping quality and the shelf life of the meat is concerned. So one, we have to exclusively ensure that whenever we are bleeding an animal, they have to be properly bled, so that all the blood from the body is removed. Okay, so the halal slaughter requires the name of Allah, that is the God, should be mentioned at the initiation of the operation. So at every initiation of the slaughtering process, if it involves halal technique or halal method, we will have to pray for Lord Allah. So ideally, the Islamic community people who are following the halal method of slaughtering of an animal, so they will pray for Lord Allah before the operation, that is before the initiation of the slaughtering technique. Okay, so this method of slaughtering ensures the blood flows off completely from the animal. So as I've already described, by hanging the animal upside down after making a deep incision in the throat, so we are ensuring that the animal is completely bled. So the blood will be completely removed, and in turn the keeping quality of the meat is exclusively increased. Okay, so draining of the blood completely from the body of an animal plays a significant role, as I have already told you, which is of microbiological significance. Okay, so this is about halal method of slaughtering technique, which is employed by the Islamic community. Okay, so next method of slaughtering technique is jhatka method. Okay, so as I've already told you, this particular jhatka method will ensure instant decapitation of an animal, meaning there will be an instant separation of head as well as the body of an animal. Okay, so the instant decapitation might happen with exclusively the sword. Okay, so as I've already described, the jhatka method of animal slaughtering is exclusively employed by the Sikh community and also Hindu religion. Okay, exclusively for the religious sacrifice of an animal. Okay, so which this method ensures that there is an instant decapitation, the head as well as the body of an animal is separated, and this particular slaughtering method is mostly employed for sheep as well as goats. Okay, so sheep as well as goats are mostly subjected for jhatka method of slaughtering of an animal. Okay, so the instant decapitation ensures that there is no supply of the blood to the body of an animal, and it will undergo instant death. Okay, so that is about the jhatka method of animal slaughtering. Okay, so next then we have another method, which is kosher method of animal slaughtering. So as I've already told you, the kosher method of animal slaughtering, okay, is employed by the Jewish community. So Jewish community exclusively employ or follow this method of slaughtering technique. So this method ensures that whenever an animal is being subjected for slaughtering, it is in its fully conscious state. That means the animal will be fully alive. Okay, so there is no stunning process which is employed as far as the religious sacrifice using kosher method of slaughter is employed. Okay, so the animal will be completely in its conscious state, but it will be hung upside down. Okay, so they will use special kind of equipment, which is a knife called as calif. Okay, so this particular knife, which is called as calif, which is the razor sharp knife of 16 inch. Okay, so it will be a 16 inch knife, which is razor sharp, and it is called as calif. Okay, so this knife is tucked into the throat of an animal. Okay, so the animal will be in its conscious state and it will be hung upside down. So after that, what we will do, we will use this particular knife called as calif and make a deep incision in the throat of an animal. Okay, so here it will be inserted. Okay, so this will in turn ensure that there is a proper bleeding in an animal, and it in turn renders an animal to kill it. Okay, so this is about the kosher method of animal slaughtering, which is employed mostly for slaughtering of an animal by the Jewish community. Okay, to give you an overview, there are three important slaughtering methods which are in place, okay, for slaughtering of an animal. So the first one is the halal method, which is exclusively followed by the Islamic community. And next thing we have the jhatka method, which is exclusively followed by the Sikh community, wherein the instant decapitation of an animal actually happens. And next thing we have the kosher method of animal slaughtering, wherein the animal is hung upside down and using a calif, which is a razor sharp knife, we will make a deep incision in the throat of an animal, in turn rendering an animal for complete bleeding, which in turn ensures a better quality of meat. So, next, in after the slaughtering of an animal, we will have to ensure that the animal is properly bled. Okay, so the blood inside the animal body has to be completely drained so that the meat quality is of better. Okay, so what is the importance of bleeding? We will have an understanding on the same. So whenever we are talking about bleeding, so the bleeding is resulting. So bleeding is resulting to the death of an animal. So how exactly? Because the blood will carry oxygen rich blood will be carried to the brain, which results in the function of the body of an animal. So whenever we are cutting that particular portion, okay, so whenever we are ensuring that there is no proper supply of oxygen rich blood to the brain, so it induces something called as cerebral anoxia. That means there is no proper supply of oxygen rich blood to the head of an animal or the brain of an animal, so which in turn leads to the death of an animal. Okay, so the bleeding knife, whenever we are making an incision, we will be using a proper tool. So the knife which is being used has to be extremely sharp, so it should not be blunt. So if it is blunt, it will induce a lot of discomfort to the animal, okay, because the incision will not properly happen, and then we will have to strike the animal multiple times to ensure that there is proper drainage of the blood. So that is the reason why the knife that is being used for slaughtering of an animal should be of sharp. Okay, and then we will also have to ensure that the animal is hung upside down during the bleeding process, because it facilitates complete draining of the blood. Okay, so a prolonged or delayed bleeding is also not advisable. Okay, so what it results in proper discomfort to the animal, because during this process of bleeding, the animal might actually gain consciousness. Okay, so the bleeding of an animal should not be delayed or it should not be prolonged. Okay, so after bleeding, it is skinned and then it is subjected for evisceration. Okay, so the delayed bleeding may also result in the increase in the blood pressure, causing the blood pressure to burst, in turn leading to hemorrhage. Okay, so the delayed bleeding should not also happen, because whenever delayed bleeding is happening, there is an increase in the blood pressure of an animal, due to which there will be the bursting of the veins which is carrying the blood, and in turn it results in hemorrhage. Okay, so the extra blood in the tissue is lead to meat getting decomposed quickly. So as I've already told you, if the animal is not bled properly, so there will be an accumulation of the blood in the tissue or muscle of an animal. So this is of highly important concern. Why?
Because the accumulation of the blood or the residue of blood, whenever it is remaining in the tissues, it will in turn leads to the or gives us a way to the microorganism to proliferate and bring about a lot of chemical changes. Okay, so that is the reason why animal has to be properly bled after performing slaughtering. Okay, so next thing we have skinning. So after bleeding of an animal, the next process is skinning. Okay, so whenever we are talking about skinning, so after the successful bleeding, so the first, the head of an animal as well as the body of an animal is separated. That is, the head as well as the body of an animal is separated. Okay, so head as well as the body. And after that, they will have to be subjected for examination. Okay, so before that, what we will have to ensure? That there is proper numbering to ensure that this particular head belongs to this particular body. So we will have to ensure that, because it will in turn gives us an idea that the problem is in this particular head or in this particular body. So for that, we will have to ensure that there is a proper numbering. Okay, so the distinct number which is same should be given for head as well as the body of a animal. Okay, and then it will be subjected for post-mortem examination. Okay, so following which, this operation of skinning is absent in pigs. Why? Because skin is a part of the carcass. Okay, so after performing or after skinning, the skinning is exclusively performed for sheep, goats as well as the cattle. Okay, so while in case of the pigs, the skinning is not performed. Why? Because the skin is a part of the carcass in case of pig. Okay, so that is the reason why skinning is not exclusively performed for pigs. Okay, so this is about the skinning process. So next then we have another process called as evisceration. Okay, so evisceration, whenever we are talking about viscera, so viscera is nothing but the inside body part of an animal. Okay, so evisceration is nothing but removing of inside body parts of an animal is regarded as evisceration. So the process is the evisceration process. Okay, so that is how we'll have to break down the E as well as the viscera. So viscera is the internal organ which has to be removed, and the process is regarded as evisceration process. Okay, so whenever we are talking about evisceration process, so as I've actually shown in this particular picture, so there has to be an incision which is made in this particular region. So whenever we are making an incision in this particular region, it will help us to remove all the internal parts of an animal, be it the heart, the kidney and everything. So whenever we are making an incision, we'll have to ensure that all the body part of an animal is removed exclusively, and the care must be taken that whenever we are removing the intestine, that is gastrointestinal tract, we will have to ensure that this particular region, that is the small intestine, is not damaged. So whenever the small intestine is damaged, what it means, it will results in the contamination, because I have already told you and we have discussed in our antemortem inspection that the GI tract of an animal will have a lot of spoilage causing microorganism, which in turn will lead to the lot of changes. So the removal of the gut, that is the small intestine, should be an utmost priority, because there is always a chances of contamination of the meat lot. Okay, so it should be carried out without damaging the internal organ. So whenever we are removing an internal organ after this incision, so we will have to ensure that there is no damage to the internal organ. Okay, and the damage to the gastrointestinal tract, that is GIT tract, may contaminate the carcass with microorganism. Okay, so with microorganism, so the GI tract, or the whenever we are damaging the GI tract, it in turn contaminates the entire carcass, because as I've already told you, it has a lot of microorganism. Okay, so we will have to ensure that there is a proper removal of the GI tract. So the carcass is then washed and carried manually or mechanically to the inspection area. So after the evisceration process, so after removal of all the internal organs from an animal body, then it will be properly washed in a hot water and then it will be mechanically passed on to the section where they will perform post-mortem inspection. Okay, so that is how the evisceration process is carried out in case of meat industry. Okay, so after evisceration, the meat or the carcass will be supplied to a region that is called as post-mortem inspection region. So where the animal will be properly examined. So all the eviscerated organ as well as the carcass of an animal will be properly investigated to determine if the meat is fit for human consumption or not. Whenever we are talking about post-mortem examination, so we will have to ensure that it is an examination which is conducted by qualified veterinary doctors. Okay, so they will in turn ensure the wholesomeness of the food. That means they will give us an insurance that the meat is suitable for consumption and it doesn't pose any kind of a food safety threat. Okay, so whenever the veterinary doctors are performing this particular inspection, so they will have to make sure that they are in their proper safety gear. That means proper head net and the proper mask and also the proper apron and the gloves are properly worn, because there is always a chances of transmission of the skin microflora from the veterinarians to the final product, that is the meat. Okay, so we will have to ensure that proper headgear and the head net and proper dressing is in place as far as the post-mortem inspection is confirmed. Okay, so the knives which are exclusively used during this process of post-mortem inspection should be of proper quality. That means it has to be thoroughly sanitized whenever or each time that we are actually using it. Okay, so to perform that, we will have to ensure that there is a proper sterilizing equipment that is provided. So there has to be a proper hot water as well as cold water facility that has to be properly provided in case of a post-mortem examination room. Okay, so the natural lighting is also one of the important consideration as far as post-mortem examination is concerned. So the facility which is required in case of post-mortem examination room. So the first thing we have the lighting. So natural lighting is considered in place of artificial lighting. So if artificial lighting is used, so we will have to ensure that the intensity of the light must be 540 lux. Okay, so the second end, the person who is carrying out the inspection needs clean, sharp and stainless steel knives. So the knives which are exclusively used, that I've already discussed, should be properly sanitized and sterilized. Okay, so there must be a provision for hot water as well as cold water in the post-mortem examination room. Okay, and also there should be a proper sterilizer to sterilize the knife. So the knife, every time that we are using it for a specific part of an animal, it has to be sterilized eventually. Okay, so for that, to ensure the sterilization, the knife should be sterilized by dipping them in boiling water. Okay, so the boiling water at least for a period of 30 minutes or by autoclaving at a temperature of 121 degrees centigrade for a brief period of 10 to 15 minutes. So this is how the knife which is used for the post-mortem examination of viscera or the carcass of an animal should be performed. Okay, so it has to be thoroughly sanitized. Okay, so sanitation should be in place, which will in turn ensure that there is no cross-contamination from the knife and to the other part of the other viscera of animal meat. All right, so I hope this concept is very much understood. All right, so next then we will have to make sure that to put a mark on the carcass. So after the post-mortem examination, where the veterinary doctor will ensure the wholesomeness of the food, so it has to be properly marked. So whenever we are marking it, we will have to make sure that whenever the adhesive that is being used or the ink that is being used are cheap and it is non-toxic and it is non-corrosive. So this is the quality of the adhesive or the ink that is being used. So we will have to make sure that it is cheap, it is non-toxic and it is non-corrosive by nature. Okay, so whenever we are marking it, so the marking can be done in three different ways. So the first thing, we can actually use the branding. Okay, so the animal can be subjected for branding. Okay, so we can ensure and we can improve it tag. Okay, so next then we can use an adhesive gum. Okay, so and we can label it. So labeling as well as branding, as well as the next thing we have, the ink that is being used. Okay, so these are the three different type of marking which will in turn ensures that the product is wholesome and safe for consumption and it does not pose any kind of a food safety threat to the consumer. Okay, so this marking will be authenticated by a veterinary doctor while he or she is performing post-mortem inspection for the viscera as well as the carcass of animal meat. Okay, so I will repeat again. So the marking can be performed in three different ways. So the first thing, we can use an ink. Okay, so and the next thing, we can use a label. And the third one is using of brand. Okay, so the brand name, whenever it is imprinted via an ink or by a tag or by a label, it will in turn ensures that the product is safe for consumption. All right, I hope this facilities which are predominantly or the preliminary requirement as far as post-mortem examination is concerned is effectively understood. Let us now have an understanding on the concept of post-mortem principle. Okay, so in the post-mortem principle, what are all the things that we will have to ensure to in turn determine the wholesomeness or the quality of the carcass or the meat? So we will be having a post-mortem principle. So the first that we will have to take into consideration is the visual perception. So as the name itself defines, so the visual perception is nothing but by visually recognizing what are all the changes or the parameteral difference that is ideally observed. So first, the carcass as well as the visceral organ should be examined visually for any kind of a abnormalities. So if the carcass as well as the visceral organ have or exhibit any kind of an unusual color, or it can be the atrophy, that is which is a general physiological reabsorption as well as breakdown of the tissue leading to the apoptosis, and also hypertrophy and neoplastic condition. So neoplastic condition includes the presence of cyst. It can be benign as well as malignant. Okay, so the tumor that might be present, which is nothing but the neoplastic condition. So visually we will have to recognize if the carcass as well as the visceral organ is exhibiting any kind of visual abnormalities as far as the meat is concerned. So this is about the visual perception. So next one is the palpation. So as we have already discussed, so the palpation is an important criteria that has to be taken into consideration. So in case of palpation, the organs are palpated for any changes in the consistency as well as its sliminess or gelation, and also it helps to determine any kind of a cyst that might be present. So in the case of antemortem inspection also, we have effectively defined and understood the concept of palpation. So what is its importance and how exactly the palpation of an animal is exclusively done to determine any kind of an abnormalities. So palpation is the second post-mortem principle that has to be effectively taken into consideration. So next then we have incision. Okay, so what exactly happened in case of incision? So in case of incision, the organs are incised, that means the organs will be cut. Okay, so only if it is needed, but it is ideally not performed. If the visceral organ or the carcass is suspected, then they can perform incision also. Okay, so it is done to examine any parasite, if there is any parasite that might be present, and also the structural deformity. So the parasite presence as well as the structural deformity which might have been occurring, so that can be effectively determined by having an incision done to the carcass or the visceral organs of a meat animal. Okay, so that is the importance of incisions. Okay, so irrespective of whatever the visceral organ it might be, so if it is suspected, then we will have to go for incision, in turn determining if there is any presence of parasite or any structural deformity which might be observed. Okay, so next one is the laboratory tests. So the laboratory test is exclusively done to confirm if there is any kind of a suspicion. Okay, so these are done to confirmation and support the observation made by macroscopic or microscopic examination. Okay, so whatever the observation that we are actually doing, so we will have to in turn confirm that. So to confirm that, we will have to send the sample to the laboratory tests. Okay, so the laboratory test will in turn give us an confirmation whether whatever that has been suspected so far, so is true or not. Okay, so this is about the laboratory test. Okay, so moving on, let us have an understanding on how exactly the judgment towards the carcass as well as the visceral organ as far as postmortem is concerned. So how exactly it is made. Okay, so the similar to antemortem examination, a complete veterinary doctor or a competent veterinary doctor has to submit a judgment report. So this judgment report can exclusively define if the carcass or the visceral organs are fit for human consumption or not, or if it is unfit for human consumption, or if there is any kind of a total condemnation. Okay, so that we will be defining by the, that will be defined by the veterinary doctor, and also the affected organs must be condemned while rest can be passed for human consumption. So this is regarded as partially condemned. Okay, so as per the judgment which is made by the veterinary doctor, okay, towards the viscera as well as the carcass, so it can be either it is accepted or fit for human consumption. That means it is not posing any kind of a food safety threat, and hence it ensures the wholesomeness, and therefore such kind of carcass or the visceral organ is fit for human consumption. Okay, so next then we have unfit for human consumption or the total condemnation. Okay, so this is nothing but the carcass or the meat or the visceral organ is unfit for human consumption. So this is because it might be posing any kind of a symptom or any kind of a food safety threat to the consumer, and hence such kind of meat cannot be accepted. So this is the second judgment that is made by the veterinarian. Okay, so next then we have the partial condemned. So partially condemned means whenever the carcass is fit for consumption, but the visceral organ are not fit for consumption. So this is exclusively because of some kind of partial infection that might have occurred to an animal. Okay, so in that case, the carcass will be consumed, but the visceral organ, whichever the visceral organ that is affected, so that will be effectively discarded, and only the one which are fit for human consumption will be subjected for further processing. Okay, so this is the judgment report that will be in turn declared by the veterinarian, veterinarian, so that to ensure the wholesomeness or the quality of the meat. Okay, so whenever we are saying partially condemned or fully condemned, what do we actually mean? Okay, so let us now have an understanding towards that. Okay, so when we say the carcass or the visceral organ is totally condemned, it is exclusively because the animal must have suffered rabies. Okay, so if the animal has rabies or anthrax or foot and mouth diseases, so these are the diseases which we have effectively understood while we are studying the antemortem inspection. So I suggest you to go back to the antemortem inspection video and have an understanding on the towards the symptoms, that is towards the rabies, anthrax as well as foot and mouth disease. So if the animal has suffered any of these diseases like rabies, anthrax, FMD, and acute enzoonotic meningoencephalitis, or contagious bovine pleuropneumonia, okay, or salmonellosis, listeriosis, calf diphtheria, calf diarrhea, or tetanus. So if the meat animal has any of these kind of a symptom after the animal has been slaughtered and examined for the carcass as well as the visceral organ, if it is exhibited any kind of this confirmation towards these diseases, then such kind of carcass as well as the visceral organ will be effectively discarded. Okay, so it will not be effectively considered for human consumption, so it will be effectively discarded. Okay, so the carcass in case of actinomycosis,
actinobacillosis, where the actinomycosis, the bacteria will be in the blood of an animal, which in turn affects all the visceral organs. Okay, so in such case, so the meat will be effectively condemned also. Okay, so that is of important thing that has to be effectively taken into consideration. So the meat will be effectively condemned and will not be subjected for further consumption when the animal is suffering from any of these above diseases that you have effectively seen in this particular slide. Okay, so next then, in case of Corynebacterium infection, carcass is passed after removal of the affected organs. That means it is partially condemned. So the Corynebacteria, if it is affecting a specific visceral organ, so that visceral organ will be effectively discarded and the rest of the carcass as well as the viscera will be effectively sent for the human consumption. Okay, so that is partially condemned one. Okay, so in case of heavy infestation, so if the animal has more than 10 cysts, okay, then the carcass is totally condemned. Okay, otherwise the carcass is passed after the removal of the head, heart, diaphragm as well as esophagus. So because most of the cysts are usually found in this particular area, so the head as well as the heart, the diaphragm as well as the esophagus of an animal is effectively removed and then it will be effectively sent for human consumption. Okay, so this is about the partial condemned. So next then we also have, if an animal has tuberculosis, so if it is localized tuberculosis, then the localized organ can be effectively removed and then it can be sent for human consumption. So if the tuberculosis is spread all throughout the body, then such kind of carcass or the visceral organ will not be subjected for human consumption. Okay, so this is about this slide effectively described what is the difference between condemned as well as partially condemned meat as well as meat partially condemned. This slide effectively gave us an idea about what is the significant difference existing between condemned as well as partially condemned carcass as well as the visceral organ. So this effectively gave us an idea about the postmortem judgment towards the meat as well as meat carcass. Okay, so this is about the importance of postmortem inspection. So how exactly the postmortem inspection of an animal has to be done, what is its significance, and also the judgment. Okay, so I hope this particular class is effectively understood, and thank you very much.